All right. Well, we've got more than 50 participants, so it's probably a good time to get started. We've had the pleasure this afternoon from hearing Dr. Colwell in a variety of formats at lunch and through several different lab meetings. And it's been so wonderful to her graciousness and also the tenacity and drivenness of her message has been really inspiring today. For those that haven't looked deeply into Dr. Colwell's CV yet, I want to give a brief introduction. She holds a BS in bacteriology and an MS in genetics from Purdue University, one of our relatively nearby neighbors. And she has a PhD in oceanography from the University of Washington. Presently, Dr. Colwell serves as a distinguished university professor at University of Maryland College Park and at Johns Hopkins University Bloomberg School of Public Health. And she's the president and chairman of Cosmos ID. She served as the 11th director of the National Science Foundation and its first female director. And she's held, as her abbreviated CV notes, many advisory positions throughout the world. And I think many is a very useful word in this context, because every time I went back to check on past talks or look at her CV again, the numbers seem to have increased a little bit every time. She's constantly publishing new and impressive things. Dr. Colwell has mentored over 130 graduate students and postgraduate students. She's published nearly 800 peer-reviewed publications, or maybe she's topped that by today. She'll have to tell us. And these publications are important and advancing knowledge to the degree that she has merited the award of over 60 honorary degrees, one of which I thought was interesting was France's Knight of the Legion of Honor. And lest you think that knightly honors are merely symbolic with Dr. Colwell, she also sails competitively. And so I wouldn't be surprised if she were also able to best all comers with a broadsword. And Dr. Colwell is also a great storyteller. She related some of her life in the recent book, A Lab of One's Own, One Woman's Personal Journey Through Sexism in Science. And in this book, Dr. Colwell has related the social and structural challenges that have prevented, up until relatively recently, 50% of our population from participating fully in human advancement and personal fulfillment. And I know her book has made a big impression on me and my family. I've talked with many of you in the audience about how useful and mind-opening the book was. It was sometimes it made us angry, sometimes it made us happy, and it also always helped us to think more broadly. So we're very grateful for Dr. Colwell's work, both in the scientific realm and in this popular realm. So Dr. Colwell, we're very thankful for your generosity and your time and your expertise. And I will turn the time over to Dr. Rita Colwell.
Thank you so much for the very kind introduction. It's a great pleasure to have an opportunity to speak with you and to talk about science. I've chosen in this afternoon's lecture to focus pretty much on the metagenomic work that I've been doing. I'll start out, though, by just setting the stage of the work that I've done over the years. Mainly, I've focused on water-related diseases. And that's because they really, when you add them up, the cases per year, it's genuinely astronomical. And the deaths per year, particularly of diarrheal diseases, cholera, is close to 2 million deaths around the world. I've done research on cholera. It's a global disease, a water-related diarrheal disease. The interesting point to make is that we are in two pandemics. We've been in the seventh pandemic of cholera since the 1960s, and it continues to this day. Cholera occurs in about 50 countries, affects about 7 million people. And we've unfairly ascribed to the Bay of Bengal the source of cholera. But really, 150 years ago, we had cholera in the US, in Washington, DC, and New York, Canada, Europe, and so forth. The discovery that we made working essentially in the Chesapeake Bay is that the bacterium that causes cholera is an aquatic bacterium naturally occurring in the aquatic environment. And so we'll really never be able to eradicate cholera, but we can control it, no question. The discovery was made in the Chesapeake Bay, showing that the bacterium, which you can see in the upper left is associated, its host is the copepod predominantly. The copepod represents about 95% of the zooplankton, the animal component of plankton in the world oceans. We developed very early on a model of the transmission of the disease, namely that in the spring, there is warming due to increased sunlight. The algae bloom, they're fed on by the zooplankton. The zooplankton carry the cholera bacteria. When the zooplankton population crashes from using up all the food supply, the vibrios are released into the water, and that begins the outbreak of cholera. Now, we were criticized when we developed this theory about the natural existence of vibrio cholerae, that, well, that may be the case in the Chesapeake Bay, but not in Bangladesh. So in 1975, we started our work in Bangladesh and have gone back every year, several times a year, except for during the last 2 years of COVID. And indeed, this is where the, and it's usually the girls in the family, collect water for the families from the ponds directly. Not exactly the most pure source. But the Bangladesh model of cholera source and transmission fit exactly what we had developed, the theory we had developed in the Chesapeake Bay work. Now, the physicians insisted that cholera was transmitted person to person. However, our work showed that it's really derives from the environment. We took the findings of these environmental controls of cholera to heart when NASA launched Landsat back in the middle 1980s. And so in 1985, 1990, it occurred to me that if Landsat was measuring chlorophyll, we could use that as a measurement along with the other parameters of the sea surface temperature measured by Landsat to predict cholera. And sure enough, when one adjusts for that time lag from the appearance of phytoplankton to the appearance of zooplankton to then the bacteria being able to infect people, and you made that adjustment, the fit was remarkable. This was published 20 years ago, showing this relationship of environmental parameters with cases of cholera in Bangladesh. The results were really dramatic. For a milligram per cubic meter increase in chlorophyll, there's about a 33% increase in the number of cholera cases in Calcutta, or now known as Kolkata. And with a millimeter per day increase in rainfall, because that's another parameter, there's about a 7% increase in cholera. And the same thing for Madlab, the village where we worked in Bangladesh. We've been able to use this predictive capacity for Yemen. In 2015, a massive epidemic began in 2016 and 17 in Yemen, the worst actually in the history of cholera. What we did was a retrospective analysis of how we would have predicted the cholera in Yemen. And you see on the left, brightly colored in blue and green and red, is our predictive map. And down to the bottom right is the actual occurrence of cholera. So we were about, at that time, about 60% accurate. We received a request from a colleague in England to ask if we could provide predictive maps of cholera on a monthly basis, 2 or 3 weeks ahead. And so now we've been doing that ever since, providing for UNICEF and the UN agencies and the British Aid Agency prediction of the risk where it would be highest so they can locate their medical care and attention. Now, I'll speak more about that tonight in my other talk, but I would like to emphasize today the work we've been doing in metagenomics, because that's, I think, as exciting, and it ties in, as I'll show tonight, to the work we've been doing on prediction. About 2004 or five, I developed the idea that if we could take DNA and RNA extracted from any sample, water, food, soil, clinical sample, sputum, blood, feces, whatever, and extracted the community DNA, sequenced it, and we developed algorithms that allowed us to be agnostic for sequencer. It doesn't matter whether it's Ion Torrent or Illumina or whatever. But we built a database of about 170,000 curated bacteria, viruses, protists, fungus. And we were able to match up, identify all of the microorganisms, the bacteria, viruses, fungus, protists, as well as their genes coding for antibiotic resistance, pathogenicity properties, metabolic properties, et cetera. So we're able to characterize and identify everything present microbiologically, including pathogens, as well as the specific genetic coded functions. What is important about the algorithm we use is that it identifies down to species and strain. Strain is important, I'm sure you can understand. For example, lactobacillus can be used to make cheese, wine, or yogurt, but it depends on the strain of lactobacillus that is used, and we can differentiate those. We've carried this work to analysis of the gut flora of diarrheal disease patients in a big study, which I do need to write up, of patients who have come into the cholera hospital in Calcutta with diarrheal symptoms. And so we carried out a three-phase study. First, we received 9 samples where they knew the patients had cholera because they could isolate the bacterium. The symptoms were strong, we treated it. And so this was a test to make sure we could really pick up the bacteria by our analysis system. Then they sent us the team, Dr. Ramamurthy, Dr. Nair, the directors, sent us another 28 samples where they couldn't isolate Vibrio cholerae. It was unknown as far as they were concerned. And then they also added samples of healthy individuals, that is most likely medical students and some of the faculty at the hospital center. And then another lot came in with another 37 samples where they had been able to isolate Vibrio cholerae, had not been able from 10 of the samples, and then another set of controls. Now, what they did was they sent us the DNA of these samples. They didn't send us the actual cultures. That's a bit of a problem to ship pathogens through the mail. So they extracted the DNA, sent that to us, and then they had, for the samples they sent us, had analyzed with all of the standard cultural techniques, the bacteria, Vibrio cholerae, Aeromonas, Campylobacter, et cetera, viruses and parasites. It was very interesting because where they sent samples where they had isolated Vibrio cholerae in the upper left, we as well identified Vibrio cholerae, but those infected infections were polymicrobial. It was also a bit of Salmonella, maybe some Shigella, Campylobacter, whatever. It was not a pure Vibrio cholerae culture. And for the unknown samples where they could not isolate Vibrio cholerae, we showed that what was causing the infection were enteric E. coli, enteropathogenic, hemorrhagic, et cetera, pathogenic strains of E. coli, along with occasionally isolations of Salmonella, Shigella, et cetera. But fascinating was the healthy control population because we were able to detect pathogens being carried by the healthy reference stool samples that from which they had extracted the DNA. But what also was interesting was that this blue segment refers to the kinds of bacteria you would pick up from yogurt and fermented milk, et cetera. And in the Indian population, if you've traveled to India, you know that almost every meal, yogurt is offered at the table. We compared all this with the human microbiome program data we downloaded from NIH. And sure enough, we do carry a few pathogens. This has been known for a long time, but not as much of the probiotic because ingestion as a food staple of yogurt is not all that common. But we were able to distinctly characterize by our technique the populations of the microbiome. We could identify, for example, this is the NIH samples. And you can see that the pathogens are not strongly present, maybe an occasional, but not present. These are the known pathogens that we picked up. Then we decided, just for the interest of science, we would accumulate all of the data on gut microbiomes published by anyone, anywhere in the literature. And so from 10 countries, we were able to accumulate 600 samples. And from the analyses that had been published and from our own, we have here essentially what one might call the median healthy gut microbiome across globally. What is more interesting, I think, as well, is that when you break down the microbiomes by country, you find that it's quite characteristic for China versus the US, let's say versus rural India or the Native American gut flora. So this was a study we need to publish, demonstrating the characteristic microbiome according, in this case, the bacteria, but similarly, we have the diagrams for viruses, protists, and fungus. But what's very interesting, I think, is that this is a forensic tool. Someone claiming to have lived in the US for a very, very long time, 20 years or more, but showing, let's say, a gut flora of this description, or perhaps of this description, clearly can be differentiated. So that, I think, has been turning out to be quite interesting. But as I said, we can do this for the protists as well. And here, the distribution of entamoeba dispar across many countries. The countries are horizontal, as listed here. And the specific parasite can be picked up. And so identified. And what makes this useful as a tool is that it allows us then to determine the dispersion or global distribution of a given strain of parasites globally. Now we've just completed a really extensive set of studies, one on Crohn's disease. In this case, 39 individuals, volunteers, 14 with Crohn's, male and female, and healthy individuals for comparison control purposes. And the distribution we selected out here to make it more dramatic of the organisms that you would find predominantly in the Crohn's suffering individual, And the predominant in the healthy individual, not present in the Crohn's victim. So that has been a diagnostic that has been very useful. And a study that we just published last in August, a month and a half, a couple months ago, in PNAS, is a study first initiated about 4 years ago with the team led by Dr. Alessio Fasano at Harvard Medical School and Mass General, along with Maureen Leonard, the senior author, in this first paper, where we have been analyzing children with celiac disease potential. What do I mean by that? The parents' genomes were sequenced, and we now have about 500 infants from birth. And this cohort includes individuals genetically predisposed, that is, they carry the genes of their parents for celiac disease, those that are offspring of parents with the genes but don't have the genes, and also parents without the genes and the children don't have the genes. And then we were determining the effect of environmental factors, cesarean delivery versus vaginal delivery, formula fed versus breast milk fed, exposure to antibiotics for treatment before the age of two, and when no antibiotics have been used. So this gives us a fascinating study that allowed us to reveal the influence of the genetic and the environmental risk factors on the kids, the offspring, whether the genes will determine that they will come down with the disease, celiac disease, or not. And here, because we've now advanced our studies to the point where we can actually look at pathways of metabolism, biofilm metabolism, fructose and mannose metabolism, et cetera. So we're able to differentiate the capabilities of the microorganisms in those who have been exposed to certain of the factors, their microbiome, and the controls that are not. So we can differentiate by the microorganism component. And here, a longitudinal study for the species that are present in the cases to the left and the controls to the right. The specificity of the strains of, for example, bifidobacterium present in the celiac children versus the bifidobacterium species present in the non-celiac babies. And this provides us, again, with a much more extensive analysis of the microorganisms and the patterns that we can ascribe to the celiac gut flora versus the healthy and normal. And the pathways. Here is a fatty acid pathways, valine, leucine, isoleucine degradation, et cetera. So we can differentiate between the celiac children and the controls by virtue of what those microorganisms that comprise the celiac community, microbial community, and their capability of metabolism, and in this case, further analysis. So it's a very, very extensive analysis, and this is available in PNAS in the August 2021 journal. We're now doing extensive work on autism, and we're looking at a number of individuals, volunteers, with the Asperger autism syndrome and the non-Asperger autism syndrome. And here is a principal component analysis of the gut floras of the two groups. And as you can see, the Asperger autism spectrum is quite readily differentiated from the non-autistic or autism spectrum group of individuals. With occasionally, we do pick up what would be a non-autistic propensity in the mix of the autistic propensity group. And we're able to break this down into a heat map showing that Bifidobacterium, Ruminococcus, and the Enterocypes species are picked up at different abundances in the autistic spectrum individuals versus the non-autistic cohorts. And this is useful because this is not a diagnostic or a cure, but it provides a mechanism for at least alleviating the gastric distress that many autistic victims or children have. And so it is useful in providing suggested dietary recommendations. For example, the Fecalia bacterium is it's a butyrate producer that can outcompete Bifidobacterium, and being able to provide a nutrient that would accelerate the Bifidobacteria would be at least one way to alleviate the symptoms. And similarly, there's a tendency for the Clostridia to be present in larger numbers proportionately in the autistic spectrum individuals. And this provides, again, a probiotic potential recommendation. And I want to really be very strong and firm and say that this is not a diagnostic, and this is not yet reached the stage of recommended treatment. However, it provides insight, and it has provided the mechanism, at least a pathway for individuals with respect to their dietary behavior. And it can help alleviate, at least in these early stages of this kind of application. And so it allows then to understand at least what is going on in the gut. And we're able to show that without any dietary, medical, or a specific lifestyle change, the microbiome really is compositionally consistent for the individuals who have been participating in this study. So there is a stability, I suppose one could say, for the composition of the gut flora, but it can be modified by dietary change. We are also launching studies on the vaginal microbiome and examining the presence of bacteria, fungus, protists, virus, as well as antibiotic resistance, because knowing the antibiotic resistance provides then an appropriate treatment. We've shown that a certain antibiotic being proposed, when we did the analysis of the gut flora, we found that there was a high incidence of resistance to that antibiotic. But what's very interesting is that, again, this probably relates to a variety of factors, but in the studies we've been doing, we can see that there's a distinct vaginal microbiome, depending geographically, in this case with the US, Sweden, and China. And so the work that we're continuing is to do more work, particularly associated with pregnancy, especially with full-term birth and premature birth, to see whether there is a possibility that this could be clinically valuable in terms of microbiomes being associated with infertility. And as I mentioned, certainly it's important to understand if there's antibiotic resistance, one wants to be sure not to use that antibiotic in treatment. And knowing that ahead of time is a very distinct advantage. And then one always is curious about the potential of the microbiome playing a role in endometriosis, as well as ovarian and other cancers. Now, another analysis that we've been very exhaustively doing is understanding the microbiome of water. This fascinates me because we carry in our gut as part of the, I guess in quotation marks, natural flora, rather odd bacteria, methanogens and iron bacteria, et cetera. And my hypothesis is that as humans, we've been drinking treated water only since about 1900, only, you know, less than 200 years ago. Before that, like the rest of the world, we drank water straight from rivers and streams and lakes, natural environment. And I suspect that we have acquired a microbiome, natural microbiome as humans, that relates to the flora of drinking water. So in this case, we were curious about drinking water per se. This is the work of Kyle Brumfield, a current graduate student. Collected, he went out and bought bottled water from the supermarket, spring water, mineral water, artesian water, and then just reprocessed tap water, which is essentially what you buy in the supermarket that doesn't have any specific label. And then we also took samples of tap water from one of the buildings and from the drinking water fountain. Interestingly, the source water does have a characteristic microbiome. We picked up archaea only in the, what's shown as a little blue square, in the natural mineral water that was sparkling water. The green dots that are encircled are essentially non-mineral water, that kind of plastic bottled water that you would buy relatively inexpensively in the supermarket. And then encircled is the star in the triangle. That's tap water that you would drink from fountains, where because of the distribution mode, one can assume acquired bacteria. But fortunately, the bacterial species, because this is all treated water, were really members of actinobacteria, proteobacteria. DNA of opportunistic plant and animal pathogens were picked up in a few samples as well. And nice to say, and I'm glad to say, no fecal indicator bacteria, no E. coli or enterococci or antibiotic resistance markers were picked up. We did pick up bacteriophages and occasional genes that had of some bacteria that had been broken up. And as I mentioned earlier, archaeal DNA was detected only in the sparkling natural mineral water. And then finally, let me close by saying that water is the challenge for the future. And in countries like Bangladesh, the individuals, those boats are homes, people, families, children are living on those boats. And then in the distance, you can see the village houses that are on the land. But the source of water is what you see in the stream, the river, you know, in front. What we did was hypothesize, because, you know, the villagers are not being helped by the DNA work. Those who live in the remote villages, way in the remote regions of Bangladesh, where we had been doing our work. But if it were true, and we believed it, that the plankton were the carriers of the cholera bacteria, then we should be able to remove the cholera bacteria by simple filtration. So we tested this in the laboratory, and we published several papers showing that you could take a crude filter like sari cloth and fold it about four or five times, and you could remove about 95% or 99% of the bacteria because they're attached to the particulate matter, the copepods in and on them, but also particulate matter. So we were able to receive funding from NIH to do a study where we trained women to be extension agents and to go out to the villages to explain to the women how they could filter the water and just use a yard of old sari cloth, fold it four or five times, put it over the mouth of the calash, and then collect their water for the household through the filter. It wasn't hard to convince them because the water is quite clear, whereas the water they've been drinking carries things that swim and it's clouded and turbid. With this technique, we were able to reduce cholera by 50%. This, I think, was a dramatic and really very important finding. And I like the words of John Muir. When one tugs at a single thing in nature, he, and I've inserted and she, find it hitched to the rest of the universe. And many students, colleagues from the International Center for Diarrheal Diseases Research in Bangladesh and Dhaka, from the NICED laboratory in Calcutta, India, students, postdocs, visitors at the University of Maryland, and collaborators really from all over the world, other universities that have allowed us over the last 30 years to make these findings. But safe water remains a global challenge. It gets worse with climate change. I've talked a lot about this in my book, but I think fundamentally, we need to focus on water as one of the major challenges of our century. This is a shot taken in Tierra del Fuego, doing some research there some years ago, where you can see the most glorious sunsets. So with all this, I'm really very pleased to have a chance to talk with you. And if you have questions, I really will be delighted to answer them if I can. So I will stop sharing and get back to the group.
Well, thank you, Dr. Colwell. That was extremely interesting data and very interesting anecdotes too. If folks would like to either raise their electronic hands and I can call on them, or if nobody's talking, you can speak up. I see Rachel Morgan Kish has a hand up right now.
You're muted, Rachel.
Hi, actually I was clapping. I'm still forming a question.
Okay. A lot of digital clapping then. Fair enough. Yes, lots of us are clapping. All right. Luis Actis, do you have a question for us?
Hi, Dr. Rita Colwell. I met you many, many years ago when I was a postdoctoral fellow with Jorge Cross in Oregon.
Oh, very right. Yes, very good. Good to see you, Luis.
Yes, so really enjoyed your presentation and the amazing work. The question I have with regard to the autistic individuals, you are looking at the pathogens or the strains or the microbiome. What about the host? How does the host determine whether you have a particular population or another? That to me is something that, are you looking at that? What do you think about that?
You mean the individual himself or herself?
Yes, yes.
Having a characteristic flora of their own.
Right.
That is modified by the fact that they are suffering from autism. Is that the question?
Yeah, that's the question.
Yes, that's why we've been doing siblings of the autistic propensity individuals to determine if there is a familial microbiome. And then what we, what we are doing is looking at a range of individuals, from those who are simply Asperger diagnosed to those who are classic autistic autism diagnosis, and seeing whether we can determine this, if there's a shift from what might be, in quotation marks, normal to a distorted or dysbiotic gut flora when the full symptoms of autism show up. And so we've been working now, I think we've got about 25 or so people that we've been kids and individuals that we've been working with. So I can't really say that there is a natural flora that's distorted. All we can say at the present time is that we can diagnose. We don't have to be told. We can be given a sample blinded, and we can determine that whether or not the individual has symptoms of autism.
Thank you. And I hope one day you understand why host has a particular microbiome. But I agree, if you can help them by giving the proper nutrition, would be very nice. Thank you for your answer.
Thank you. I saw a question flashed up about celiac disease.
Yeah, even before that one, Dave Gorchov was asking, does boiling kill Vibrio and prevent cholera? And is that feasible for villagers?
Absolutely, boiling is fine. It's no problem. But in Bangladesh, in the remote villages, there's no fuel wood. In fact, the women collect the cow dung. I spent a lot of time in Bangladesh and the villages. They collect the cow dung and dry it, and that is used for cooking. So there is boiling water would be the simple way to deal with the problem, but there's not enough fuel wood to do that. And so filtration is a much better source of treatment. What's interesting is we were asked whether this was sustainable. And so 5 years later, we went back to the villages, and it was difficult because the control villages had learned about filtration and the women were filtering too. But what we did learn was that there's a herd effect. If you're a family surrounded by those who filter, you're protected as well. So I thought that was interesting.
That's great. Dr. Morgan Kish.
Thank you. That was a really great talk, Dr. Colwell. So I worked on Vibrio harveyi in the lab years ago in John Cronin's lab on bioluminescence. And does cholera have bioluminescence?
Wonderful question. Yes. Yes, that was one of the first things I looked at, the genes for Lucifer and luciferase reaction. About 10, I'm racking my brain now, but 10 to 15% of all strains are luminescent. And again, that's a good argument. And the others carry bits and pieces of the gene complement for luminescence. And you know, when I was being criticized so terribly 20 years ago, my reaction was, what's a self-respecting human pathogen doing carrying bioluminescent genes?
Yeah, absolutely. Thank you.
Cool. So Michelle Little was wondering, what is it about celiac that alters the gut microbiome?
Whoa. I'm not a physician. There are specific genes that control functions, and I'm going to have to say the paper in PNAS, I think, covers some of that. Maureen Leonard is the physician. As I vaguely remember, it's some of the metabolic pathways are inefficient and some are incomplete. But it's genetically controlled. In other words, not completely. There are genes that do indicate and predispose to celiac, but you can still get celiac without those genes. So there may be yet other genes to be detected, or there may be specific environmental imposition that can make you predisposed to celiac. That's a kind of complicated answer, but it's a complicated disease.
Sure. Sarah Johnson was wondering about research on the autism spectrum disorder. Do you think that similar studies could lead to the use of microbiomes as a diagnostic tool in the more controversial disorders such as ADHD?
I do. What we're finding, we were doing a study, it's very incomplete, with a team studying the transport of certain compounds across the blood-brain barrier. This was we were working with apes, I think. This was a colony, and we haven't completed the study, but clearly there are compounds that do influence the sense of well-being and can influence behavior produced in the gut that is transmitted across the blood-brain barrier. And some estimates are that really we're about 80% microorganisms. It's just that our cells are bigger. So this relationship of the gut, as well as the skin, the lungs, and elsewhere in the human body, is a very, very sophisticated interaction. And I think we're going to learn more and more as these studies are being done by teams in the US and in other countries.
That's really neat. It sounds like we have future careers for lots of students all lined right up.
Absolutely.
Could I follow up on that question?
Please.
Yes. So have you looked at a relationship between people that have cognitive decline or Alzheimer's and the connection of the dysfunctional microbiome in the gut, for example?
We've been doing a lot of work on Parkinson's. We've started some work on Alzheimer's, and I think that can be fruitful. Not, again, I want to emphasize, not as a cure, but it could be an indicator. And it could also contribute, I'm just hypothesizing now, you could modify, I believe, the gut that would in a way influence some of the compounds that contribute to, let's say, Alzheimer's either initiation or expansion. So I think this is something that needs to be looked into. But as I say, we've done a lot of work with colleagues on Parkinson's, and it's again quite distinctive. You can determine Parkinson from a non-Parkinson individual.
So there hasn't been any move to try to alter their microbiome to see if they become better?
Yes, because one of the persons we're working with, her husband, she's a remarkable, remarkable individual, has learned so much about the microbiome and Parkinson's. And there are some things that can be done, but nothing dramatic. I mean, nothing that we can say, aha, do this and you'll be feeling better or you'll have less tremor or whatever. But I assure you that Martha, the colleague who is working on the Parkinson, is trying everything possible. And her husband is doing very well, actually.
Thank you very much.
Any other questions from anybody? I'm not seeing any other digital hands raised. All right. Well, we'd like to thank Dr. Colwell for all the time she spent with us already today. We will convene back again shortly after 6 o'clock. We will start broadcasting, but then at 6:30, the 47th annual Hefner Lecture will begin. And so we hope to see you all then. And we thank you for all the digital applause that's going on the screen right now.
Thank you very much. It's been a pleasure. I've enjoyed every minute. Thank you all.